Welcome back to the second video of our Biomes and Spawners tutorial series for Gaia. This time we will set up our working terrain in the project and create our texture spawners. Here's a sneak peek of the final result for this video. Texturing sets the foundation for the look of our biome and helps creating the impression that we are looking at actual plains and mountains when the terrain mesh is shown. Let's get started by creating our terrain with Gaia. We will open a new scene that we can work with first. We should rename it so we can find it back again later if we need it. In the new scene, we open the Gaia Manager first, and then we can create a new terrain from the standard tab under Create World. The default settings for terrain size and so on will just do fine. We do want to switch the biome selection to custom, otherwise Gaia would add an already existing biome to the scene, and we want to create a new biome from scratch. If I do not add any spawners to my custom biome, this will create an empty new biome together with the terrain. For the workflow, I would choose to generate our terrain with a stamper. It would be possible to start with the world designer as well, but I just want to put a simple stamp down for a test terrain that has a lot of flat areas. The Kitbash asset pack has a lot of large buildings that will need some flat space on the terrain to spawn properly. When creating the terrain, Gaia asks us if we want to set up default lighting, which we accept, otherwise it can be difficult to properly see your terrain in the beginning. The stamp selection dialog opens by default when starting out with the stamper. We can browse through the available stamps in this little window. This stamp here looks like it would be right for our purpose. I do want some water on it as well, so I will raise the sea level a little bit. The area over here will make for some nice wasteland lakes later. I apply the stamp and stamp it down with the stamper tool. Now that we have created our working terrain, we can save the scene. And now we can take a quick refresher on how manual texturing works in Unity without Gaia being used. This will help us understand better how Gaia makes use of the Unity terrain system and why it makes sense to build up the texture spawners in a biome in a certain way. We would start by selecting the terrain and then putting the terrain inspector into texturing mode. Then we can add a new layer to the terrain. A terrain layer is a collection of textures that define the look of a certain surface on the terrain. Initially, I am supposed to add a color texture first, so I will add a dirt texture here. I need to reduce the brush size a bit so that we can actually see something from the terrain. That's better. The diffuse texture defines the color of the surface, and I can add two more texture maps to improve the overall look of the layer. The normal and mask map contain additional information about lightening and smoothness, which influence the look of the surface on the terrain. This might be a good opportunity to talk about the two terms terrain layer and terrain texture. The collection of diffuse, normal and mask map is called a terrain layer in official Unity terms, but if you talk to other developers, it is more common to hear the term terrain texture or only texture for the entire thing. So if there's talk about terrains and people mention the textures on the terrain, they most likely mean the terrain layers. Returning to our tutorial terrain, you probably noticed that the entire terrain took on the look of our first layer immediately when I created it. This is standard behavior of Unity. The first texture on the terrain becomes the default texture that is displayed everywhere. If you want to display other textures on the terrain, which you probably want at some point, those need to be painted on top of the default texture. If you want to remove the other texture again, you would need to paint the default texture back. What we get relatively often as question is, how can I erase textures? I want to erase so I can see the original checkerboard texture again to start over. The problem is, you can't. At the point where you got multiple textures on the terrain, you can only shift around distributions between those textures, which means painting texture A over texture B, and so on. But there is no eraser tool, as you would know it from your image processing software. What you can do is you can completely remove all terrain layers from the terrain, But as soon as you add the first layer back, you would get this as a default texture again. It is therefore the best to free yourself from the idea that you need to erase the textures, but rather you should think like, what is my default texture that should appear everywhere, and what do I want to paint off top of that? You have already seen in the video while explaining those rotations how manual terrain texturing would work in Unity. You would select the layer you want and paint it on. This is okay for a small quick project, but it would take you far too much time in a bigger scene. So, let's use Gaia to get those textures on. When we created the terrain earlier, Gaia created an empty custom biome along with it, which we can find under Gaia Tools. We can use this as a template to build up our new wasteland biome, so let's start by giving it the right name. A biome is a collection of spawners, so we need to add some spawners of course. We can do this with the button in the spawners panel. This will create a new spawner and automatically add it to the biome as well. This spawner also needs a name, so we can identify it later. We will call it Wasteland Textures. The spawner has roughly three sections. The spawn settings on the top, the rules section in the middle, and advanced features in the spawner buttons at the bottom. The spawn rules define what this spawner spawns on the terrain, so we need to add an entry here for a texture spawn rule. I can create the first rule with this button. By default, this opens a new spawn rule for texture spawning with a lot of settings exposed. Let's step back a little first. A spawn rule has a name and resource settings. The resource defines what we are spawning with this rule. There are different types of resources, textures, trees, game objects, and so on. We are happy with the terrain texture resource type already. This is exactly what we want to create. Each resource has different settings that define the resource. For a terrain texture, we would need to supply the different texture mask for the terrain layer. And a tree resource would require different settings to define a tree on the terrain. Let's keep going with the terrain texture type and create our first resource now. We want to create a wasteland biome, so we need a couple of depressing textures, sand, dirt, mud, and so on. For the sake of this tutorial, I will select a few textures based on my gut feel what I want to achieve. Normally, in a larger production, there would be concept artists, technical artists, and environment artists involved, but this would exceed the scope of this tutorial. For our first texture, I have chosen to add a sand texture. This texture will be displayed on all areas underwater, for the beach areas close to the water, and last but not least everywhere where there is no other texture defined, since this is my default texture. To create the resource, I simply need to fill out the required texture map fields. I will do this now and select the maps belonging to the sand texture that comes with Gaia. Do not have to use the selection window as I'm demonstrating here. You could also browse your project hierarchy and drag and drop in files from there. We should name the spawn rule and the resource to keep track of our stuff. Note how a name was assigned to the resource automatically from the first texture. This is normally good enough to keep order, but we should definitely name the spawn rule. Creative as we call it sand. We can click the visualization icon to see where this texture will appear, and it will be appearing everywhere. This is fine since this is our default texture, it will act as our reset for texturing at the beginning of the spawn and then all following textures will be painted on top. Let's spawn this texture now to see if that works. You can use both the spawn local and the spawn world button in this scenario. The spawn local button will only spawn on the exact area that is within the range of the spawner. The spawn world button would always possess the entire world, including terrains that are currently not loaded in the scene view. I select spawn world and here's our first texture. Let's take a closer look at this texture now. It is a bit too shiny for my taste, but this is something that we can fix in the channel remapping. This is a feature of the Unity Terrain Shader in HDRP and allows us to adjust the different effects of the mask map texture. I need to click Refresh Terrain Prototype to apply these settings, And yes, that is better now. Note that the texture resource has the same settings like the Unity terrain layer has, and any changes you make here are mirrored to the terrain layer. For example, if I adjust the size of the texture and refresh the prototype, the size changes and you can see that change on the terrain layer as well. This means anything you could set up in Unity by hand, you can also control with Gaia. This also applies to the other two native terrain resources, terrain trees and terrain details. Let's add our second texture, a dirt texture this time. We need some generic surface for all areas above the water. I will add a new spawn rule to the list, and just as with the sand texture, I will add the texture maps for the dirt texture. This is another texture that comes with Gaia. Again, I'm using the selection window to pick the individual texture maps. And we are done with the setup. I just mentioned that we want this texture to only appear over the water surface. That puts us a bit in a pickle. If we look at the visualization, the new texture would appear everywhere on the terrain, just like the sand texture. There is no restriction to that yet. Per default, the spawner will place new resources just everywhere on the terrain where it can. We need to limit it somehow, so our resources appear where we want them. The mechanism responsible for this in Gaia is called masks. Masks supply you with a rulework that allows you to precisely put things where you want them on the terrain. There are a lot of different types of masks for different requirements that allow you to filter the terrain in various ways. Masks can also be combined with each other to create amazing results. Back to our dirt texture to see if we can filter it by height. Each spawn rule has a so-called mask stack where you can define where the resource should appear. It is currently empty, so let's add our mask and switch the operation to a height mask. You can immediately see in the visualization that the lower parts of the terrain are now left out for this texture, which is exactly what we wanted. The height mask curve represents how the transition and strength takes place on the terrain. If we edit the curve, we can influence the transition. For example, choosing this curve will give a bit harsher, more defined result. I like that one because I want a sharp transition between the sand and the dirt texture. This will make for a more defined strip of beach above the sea level. I can adjust the curve further to get all kinds of interesting effects. If I edit the curve like this, for example, you can see how the strength increases first with the racing height, then falls off here, and then raises in strength again. Below the curve, you can find settings for where or in which height range this transition should take place. You can decide to set up values either in relation to the sea level or in world space independently of the sea level. You can also decide to either work with relative percent values or absolute meter values. With the slider or number entry fields below, you can then adjust the range of the transition. Both slider and number entry fields have the same effect, it is just a different way to enter data. Note how the transition gets even sharper when I let it take place over a very small range. It is also important to know that the transition will keep its last value beyond the minimum and the maximum of the range. You could say it is open-ended of sorts. We often get support requests where users tell us that they've set the mask up to go to a specific meter value, but it still goes beyond that value. This is not a bug. If you want the transition to stop at the end, you need to bring the strength of the curve down to zero at the end, and this strength value of zero will then be kept for everything beyond the maximum height. If you wanted the fade in and out to be softer, you would set up a hill-like curve like so. This all might seem a bit confusing at first, but once you are used to it, you will find that this system is very flexible and allows you to make all kinds of possible height selections and transitions. When it comes to the relative to sea level setting, you need to decide if you want the texture to adapt to a changing sea level. Imagine this height mask would run on a different terrain with a changed sea level. Since we set it up to adapt to the sea level, this is no problem. The transition changes accordingly, and we will always have a nice strip of beach above the water. If I set it up to use meters in world space instead, that transition will always take place exactly there, no matter where the sea level is. All this talking made me hungry for some textures, so let's finally click the spawn button to spawn the dirt texture on the terrain. And here it is. Let's zoom in and take a closer look. This texture comes out a bit shiny as well, so let's fix that in the channel remapping again to tone down the smoothness. With the smoothness fixed, let's take a look at our transition at the beach. That looks good as well. It is on the one hand soft enough so that you can't see an artificial border between the two textures, on the other hand it is defined enough so that you can see there is sand along the water, and then it changes to a different texture. I will now continue to add more textures, but I will skip the resource setup part since you have seen that two times already. We will rather focus on the chosen textures, what their role is, and how they were set up with the mask system. I'm back and I added another texture to the terrain. This time it is a darker dirt texture that also comes with Gaia Pro. This texture is supposed to do multiple things. First, I wanted to break up the tiling of the original dirt texture a bit. Let's zoom in a little so you can see it. You can see this repeating pattern here on the terrain, which gives me bad 90s video game vibes. It is possible to reduce that by using advanced shader tricks, but here we will solve this with creative texturing. Then I wanted to accentuate those ridges in the terrain a bit. It gives the impression that different kind of soil managed to accumulate there, and it is not fully dried out yet, unlike on the open terrain. I also wanted to bring out those micro details of the stamp a bit. The stamp has a lot of interesting little bumps and notches, and they are barely visible at the moment from a distance. We need some contrast to make those more prominent. To do so, I set up two masks. A hiked mask, which you know already, and a slope mask. The slope mask is very similar to the hiked mask, but instead of hiked, it, surprisingly, measures slope instead. This means you can make textures appear on the terrain only when it has a certain angle. Let's test that in the visualization. You can see how the texture begins to appear more and more steep terrain as I adjust the curve. Having the visualization active while adjusting the settings is always a good idea, as you can check the outcome of your edits in real time. I wanted the texture to appear everywhere above the water, so I put up a hiked mask, but then wanted to restrict it further according to the terrain angle, so a slope mask was needed. Like the hiked mask, the slope mask is open-ended as well, so I set up this hill-like curve to bring the strength in and out again in a range from 0 to 10 degrees of slope on the terrain. This seems to put the texture where I want it, so let's try to spawn it. And this is a nice result already. The tiling is broken up a bit now, and the details are accentuated by this texture. Please note that it is not mandatory to spawn a darker texture like this for every terrain. This is just something that I decided I wanted to do, but depending on your goals, you might decide to do something entirely different with your texturing. In a friendlier scene, you might decide to put up grass on larger surface areas instead, or spawn fallen leaf textures because you plan to make a forest. Moving on to the next textures. Next, I decided that the really steep parts of the terrain should not have any dirt sticking to them, but rather expose more rocky textures, as the soil would not stick to those steep areas anymore. I set up a grayish rubble texture that is also contains some loose rocks, and another edgy rock wall texture. The plan is to have the rubble texture spawn with the beginning incline on the terrain and then the hard rock texture on the even steeper areas. This should give a nice transition between flat, somewhat steep, and cliff-like areas. To achieve this, I simply set up two slope masks with a linear incline, the one for the rubble from 5 to 13 degrees and the rock wall from 10 to 25 degrees, so it appears on steeper areas. These values I did find out simply by experimentation off camera. You can activate the visualization for both textures at once to see them on top of each other. This looks good to me, so let's spawn it. That looks quite nice already. If we zoom in, we can see that both texture types complement each other. It looks like the rubble was rocks that are broken off from the rock wall texture. There is one issue though. On larger steep walls, the rock wall texture is a bit too dominating, and there's the danger of tiling when this is applied to a larger area and viewed in the distance, for example over here. To fix this, we are adding a noise mask to the rock wall texture to make it randomly mix with the underlying rubble texture. The noise mask has a lot of settings that would require their own tutorial video to fully explain them. What you do need to know for now is that you can use the noise mask to generate random patterns based on different computer noise algorithms. Noise has its own scale, and I want to make sure it generates a good pattern to break up our rock wall. So I'm going to zoom out a bit. I want a lot of small little blobs disturbing our wall texture. You can adjust the noise scale and position by scrolling with your mouse wheel in the noise preview image and also by dragging it around. As always, keep an eye on the preview to see how the settings of the noise mask are applied to the terrain. If we spawn this now, we can immediately see how the rock wall texture is less dominant in those areas now. I think I might even have overdone it a bit, so let's tone down the nose again. You can do so by adjusting the strength curve. I will put in a sharper transition, but also lift up the base strength to 0.25 so that the rock wall texture comes out a bit stronger overall. I'm happy how it looks in the visualization now, so I think I can spawn this. I think this looks better now. You can still see the edges of the rock wall texture, but with more variety and less patternization. Moving on to the last texture. For the final texture, I was a bit unhappy how the larger flat areas covered by the dirt texture looked like. I added a dry grass-like texture to spawn on the dirt texture in flat plane areas. Let's look at the mask setup. We've got a terrain texture mask that references the dirt texture rule. In this way I can make sure that the new texture will appear only where the dirt texture was spawned. I've set up a noise mask since I did only want to spawn smaller islands of dead grass inside the dirt texture, and then I used a slope mask with a declining transition to make this texture only appear on flat areas. As always, we can take a look at the visualization to check if the texture will appear in the spot where we want it, and then run the texture spawner again. The grass texture alternates with the dirt texture in the flat areas and makes the terrain a bit more interesting to look at, especially from up close. This will be enough textures for now. HDRP has a limit of 8 textures and we have used 6 so far. I would like to keep 2 slots in reserve in case we will still need them later. In general, you want to use as little terrain textures as possible, as additional textures can cost memory and performance depending on your terrain shader. The texture spawner is complete and can now be used to retexture the terrain we are working on. This is great when you happen to accidentally edit the texture, as I'm demonstrating here. It also allows you to change the height map of your terrain during development with confidence, as you know the texturing will just adapt when you are respawning the textures. You can now also save all settings into a spawner file via the advanced panel of your spawner. Just choose a location and a name for saving the file. And it will appear there when the saving is done. This allows you to add the spawner into a different terrain in another scene by using the button in the inspector. The spawner will appear in the Gaia tools and can be spawned in the same way as in the scene it was created in. Since we took good care of setting up the rules adapting to the sea level, hiked and sloped where needed, this Warner transfers fine to a different terrain. Time to enjoy what we created together over the course of this video. While we watch this epic flyby, let's sum up the key takeaway points for creating a texture spawner. Textures in Unity are painted on top of each other. You should define a default texture first, and all other textures will then be spawned on top of each other. To spawn a texture, it needs to be set up as a resource in the spawn rule first. Then you can set up masks to define where the texture should go. Masks can be combined to create very elaborate setups. By adding more and more rules with different masks, you can create a complex texturing setup according to your artistic vision. Be aware that you should not add too many textures. There's an 8 texture limit on the HDRP terrain shader, and additional textures may cost you performance. As mentioned before, nothing from the texturing setup in this video is something that you absolutely have to do when creating your own texture spawner. There is no written rule that you need to have a rock texture on slope terrain, for example. To develop your own rules, try to identify areas on your terrain that would benefit from their own texture. Check for areas that need contrast in color, and try to find semantic reasons why a certain texture appears on the terrain. A sand texture appears close to the water for a beach, a rock texture on cliffs because the soil would not stick to the steep walls anymore. Leaves would appear on the ground because you plan to place trees on there later, and the trees would deposit leaves there over time. If you need more information on masks or the spawner itself, note that almost all input fields in Gaia use mouse over help to explain what a certain field is good for. You can also click the small question mark icon to receive more detailed help text directly in the UI. These also can contain links to the full documentation, for example here for the spawner or here for the mask system. Here you can find all different mask types explained with examples. I hope you liked this tutorial on creating a texture spawner in Gaia. Next time we will take a look on the GameObject spawner to spawn some of those kitbash assets. See you there!